workers' caseloads, and we try and, with the new reorganisation of social care, now we've got more team managers being much more rigorous at tracking individual children's cases, so that no child is kind of stuck or waiting for something to happen.
Thank you.
Right, I've got Wendy and then Treena.
I've got one question for Julia and one for Graham, if I may. Julia, where's it gone? percentage of families with an under five having sustained contact with the children's centre, it's on page 22. It's dropped a little at the moment. I assume you're going to be keeping a careful watch on that as you restructure children's centres and look to see how contact falls out as time progresses. Do you have particular things in place that will help you do that?
We do, and certainly it's a prime focus for us to make sure those vulnerable children are engaged. We've got much clearer traffic processes when we start being used now. And certainly through the whole Ofsted assessment process that we've been through, our last Ofsted being improved on the previous two, we're on the right track for kind of monitoring the engagement of children and the targeted children's group. We will keep an absolute clear focus on that as we go through.
Forgive me, I have another one for you, Julia. Sorry, to give a chair. The EQ, the schools are buying it back at a lesser rate. Is that going to have problems with the creation of a new company and so on? If schools are using it less?
I anticipated you might ask this. I've asked for an update this afternoon.
It's an annual service level agreement, my understanding is. So I'm saying, has it increased? We've got, that is the figure. That is it as it currently stands. The lead manager for Wirral, Stuart Burnley, is saying that he has contacted the schools who've not bought back this year. And none of the schools are saying this is an issue about quality. And the schools are saying it's linked to the school's budgetary pressures. So what we're doing with the new trading services company, which becomes fully operational by December this year, that's essential, it's called, is coming up with a new offer, and we'll be kind of rigorously going out and engaging with all schools to try and drive up the take.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great, the proportion of adults with a learning disability live in their own home or with their family. It just says that there's a backlog of downward change in circumstance claims. I wondered how big a backlog and how long it will be if we were able to clear it. It's on page 24. Or 6 of 18.
Self-harm for 10 to 24 year olds, since it's not applicable to court because it's been developed with key partners, who those key partners are, and a little bit more about that. Thanks,
Julian. Okay. This is quite exciting, is one word, but important work strand that's been developed under a framework of work, particularly with our health colleagues, called Vision 2018. And it's now included within, I think it's Health and Rural Awareness at the time, with the Vanguard initiative. So we have a consultant, CAMS psychologist, Fiona Kender, who's doing some great work with our schools, who's leading on this as a work strand. And this has come about from conversations I've had with a number of head teachers, particularly from the selective girls' grammar school, who were talking about young women experiencing acute pressure, perhaps parental pressure to achieve, but particularly peer pressure, you know, to look good, to achieve, to be everything. And that the right phrase is copycat effect sometimes, when incidents with young people, and particularly where the young woman who was killed on the railway line a number of months ago. So, Young women are really affected by this, and the head teachers, a number of them, are really, really worried about their youngsters. And what they were saying to me is they may self-harm and end up in hospital, and we don't know about it. And there was an issue about whether the hospital felt they could share the information with the school or the breaching confidentiality. So what we've got Fiona to do is she's developing a pathway for young women who might be at risk of self-harming, working with the head teachers in that pathway. And we're going to be launching that from January next year, and making sure that we deliver a really comprehensive training programme for people to become alert to some of the vulnerability of these young women, so an early intervention approach. There's a second piece of work, which is when and if young people do self-harm and they rush to hospital, how that pathway works and how we get all the key people involved in the communication to try and make sure that doesn't happen again or reduce the risk of further instances. So we're struggling at the moment to have an indicator, but one of the crude indicators, certainly about the hospital route, might be where we started with the number of hospital admissions. And it's clearly really beneficial to the marginally young women not to be admitted to hospital if we can intervene early and prevent the self-harm happening. And as a consequence of getting in early, you save money in reducing the number of hospital admissions. So it's better outcomes on every front. So we just need to get some good indicators, but we're still working on that at the moment.
Thanks, Julia. That captures a lot of data for young women in school age. My concern is young males, going up from school and leaving school age to 24. And where is that data being captured? Because a lot of young males, you know, take their own lives or threaten to take their own lives. And I'd just like to know where is that data being captured if not here? Is that part of this process?
I think that the current process is largely focusing on young women, but let me take that question back and ask, are they focusing on all young people, not really adult? Certainly it shouldn't just be gender specific. And this is national data that's collected, so we must be collecting the 10 to 24 data on the rural footprint. I'll find you with a bit more information about that.
Into account the anorexia, because I know there was an issue with anorexia with that same cohort of girls that you're talking about, bulimic, eating a little bit, vomiting. Is that all tied in with that, or is it a separate issue?
Right, we feel that it should be tied in with it, but let me find out. I'm not 100% clear.
Julie, can I just ask you about the
the pupil premium, because I know there was an introduction of free school meals for up to 5 year olds, or the free school the meal. Does that have an impact on the take up of the pupil premium? And will the schools be getting less income as regards that? Has that been monitored at all?
Chair, it is being monitored. I think it's in this performance suite, is it?
I just see that champagne trying to take up universal income free school meals.
Right.
But I didn't. I was aware last year that the government introduced free school meals
to age groups.
Yeah. And there was some concern that the schools wouldn't be claiming pupil premium because it was related to schools, free school meals, and there was some danger of the schools losing that pupil premium income because of the uptake. Have you got any information around that at all?
Right. I perhaps need to provide you with a separate briefing note. My understanding on the data that we've got here, that the uptake of free school meals hasn't reduced with those children who are receiving universal infant free school meals. There is an issue in general about uptake of free school meals and consequently then the schools getting the pupil premium. And that was an issue you've perhaps seen in the press. It's something that Frank Field is in particular championing. So I don't think it's specifically around those two age groups where they get free school meals, and you may think, well, why would parents bother to claim? There's been a lot of publicity produced internally by our welfare rights, our welfare benefits service under Malcolm Flanagan. So the people who deal with claims for free school meals have really said to parents, you must still claim even though the child gets a free meal, because the school actually gets a lot of money. It's over 1,300 for infant children per child, so there's that massive benefit. Piece of work that we're looking at locally that we've agreed we're going to do is if parents are claiming certain benefits, if they tick a certain box, that would entitle the authority to claim for the free school meals on their behalf. So they don't need to make a separate application. And that's something the head MP has pushed forward with his focus on child poverty, because he's picked up that some of the local authorities are doing that. We've agreed that we'd adopt that same approach, because I think overall there's something in the region of £600,000 that schools aren't receiving because parents aren't all claiming. So it's a more general point. I don't think it's specifically focused on the parents and the claim for children in those two bands at infant schools getting free meals.
Well, we've shown through the chair, will we get any data on that compared to the pupil premium rates that was before the free school meals universal, and what's missing now? Will we get any data?
I can find numbers. I think in here it's just it's saying that the actual was higher than the target at 87%, but in terms of what loss of kind of income to the schools, would you like me to quantify that?
Yeah.
Yes.
Can I just add an addendum to that, Julie? There are, I know, the parents in my ward that will not claim free school meals because they don't want their neighbours and their children's parents to know that they're on the road. And that's from a head teacher in one of the schools in my ward. They just won't, so the school is deprived of that income for the simple reason that they're crying out that.
I think there is something about whether children, a fear of whether children will be singled out in a school setting if they're known to claim free school meals. And there must be, and we've asked this question of head teachers, and they've bent over backwards to make sure that other children don't know. But there's perhaps some more work. I don't understand that. to school meals as a whole, in view of, you know, possible costs. I have been asked that by a local head teacher, so I just thought I'd put it.
I think that's potentially a political question. I'm not sure I should stray into. I have read an article at the weekend where it was debating whether that would continue or not, but who knows? I can't really express a view, but yes.
The Daily Mail said it was going, but.
It's that paper I was reading.
Clearly, 2.2, the background to tell that throughout the year, corporately, for the whole council, we were reporting and we spent prime energy to slippage on specific projects and pressures within parts of the directorate. The council outturn was an understanding of £500,000. However, what you'll see on the second page of the report in section 4.2 is that within that, the adult social services had an overspend of £2.457 million, and children and people had an overspend of £349,000. The reasons for those overspends are in the table 4.24, for adults that was primarily to do due to additional care packages, that in essence that was offset to a degree by reductions in staffing costs and additional income. And for children's services, the primary pressure was to do with residential costs, transport overspend, again offset by some reductions in the connection service costs and reduced staffing in the town costs. In terms of an overview, the, those overspends were carried forward into this year's budget, 2015-16, for delivery, and specific part of this year's budget in terms of how those will be taken forward.
About the outturn, are we, is it driving for both that and quarter one? I'm not, I wasn't quite sure, because I think it's all under the same agenda item. Just really a couple of things, and it's a general comment, it's a sort of criticism, but it isn't, at the same time it isn't, if you know what I mean, it's good and typical. Sounds like a Lib Dem now. We do set ourselves really hard targets in trying to make savings. And they're not easy to implement, but somewhere along the line we've got to be more realistic about what we can achieve, particularly in the first year that we set the target, because we do seem to fail to reach the target in year one. Maybe over a period of time we will get there, but we're not. In time and time again, we do fail to get there, and we do I think when we're drawing up the budget, we do be a little bit more realistic about it. And I notice now in quarter one, we're going to take money out of the general reserve in order to cover the shortfall. But I guess, unless there's a decision to alter the way we calculate the general reserve, we're going to have to try and find a way to put that money back at some stage. So it just makes our problems even more difficult, and the pressure on you to make even more savings all the more greater.
Yes, I would agree with all of that. I think that clearly some of the savings have been particularly challenging, both in last financial year and also in this particular financial year as well. Obviously, the quarter one paper also refers to this current financial year and how those savings are. But yes, they are challenging savings. And I know that one of these savings were put forward, that Gina did highlight that many of the savings were challenging in terms of their being able to deliver them. A lot of this is about reviewing care packages, reducing the cost of care, those types of things, because certainly from an adult's perspective, most of the money is in people's care packages. So that it's not an easy area to take money out of, but if we look at what we spend on families and wellbeing across the council, we do spend the most significant proportion of the council's money. So in the context of our reducing budget, then we clearly do need to identify the savings. But you're absolutely right. There has been a high level of ambition in terms of the level of savings.
But to me, it's more to do with the speed that you can achieve the savings rather than really with the actual amount that we're trying to save. And it's that that we're not very good at, for all sorts of reasons, purposes, different reasons.
On page 48, it makes reference in the top paragraph. It makes reference to the cuts to the public health budget of 2.4 million. And I know it says that officers are currently identifying mitigating actions. I was just wondering if it was possible to be shared with some kind of an options proposal that they were looking at in terms of how they were going to
My understanding is that piece of work isn't yet complete. I'm looking over it. I don't think that piece of work is yet complete. I mean, clearly it's a big challenge for the council. The public health resources, investing contracts, commissioned services, as well as supporting the council services. And there's some very difficult decisions to make about where the money can come out of, because obviously for some of the areas of spend for the health, it can't come out because it'd be a longer term contract or anything else. So there's some very difficult decisions to be made about it, particularly for me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank In terms of the response, I think that I started answering questions from the quarter one report. Would members want to specifically pick out any key questions from the quarter one report? Although I only presented the cover sheet for the NPO report, I think the answers sort of got into the quarter one module. Are there any particular questions people want to pick up on the quarter one?
It's just a quick one, thank you, Chair. Page 49, which is 5.2. Children and young people specialist services. High cost residential and foster care placements have increased. I just wondered why, really. We lost some foster carers, or we got some particularly difficult young people that we're looking after, challenging young people.
We currently have 50 young people in independent residential placements. We have, over the last sexual exploitation. A number of those young people have been placed in residential placements, independent selective residential placements, away from home. What we're doing at the moment is we've got a children's looked after project plan to look at how to make the savings but also make the care right for the youngsters. So we've got a real eye on good outcomes for these young people. So we are identifying a number of young people who are 16, 17, not these marginal young women at risk of sexual exploitation, who are looking at their care plans, and they're probably youngsters who've been in care for a long period of time. We're looking at all these youngsters who we expect, and through talking with them, they tell us they're going to go home on their own terms. And then are there plans and measures we can put in place to bring them home sooner? Because if an external residential person is £3,000 a week, even if you spend £1,000 a week on a really brilliant preventative support package, you could possibly step them down and bring them home. I think the increase is leveling off a bit, but it's due to a higher identification and prevalence. I'm not sure whether it's prevalence or greater awareness. I think it's more the latter that's happening all over societies about child sexual exploitation. We understand that the more we know, the more we see is the motto. But at the same time, we are looking at how to bring that overall number down by really dissecting what the plan is for each young person out of the 50, and can we move plans a bit quicker, certainly for some of the older youngsters. I just want to, I tossed the coin about who should do which bits this evening. I just wanted to give you a bit of an overview on the council plan. And then obviously Graham's here, Julie's here representing public health, and I'm here representing children's services. So we can all talk about any aspects of the plan. Largely the people aspects, I guess, but some of the other cross-cutting themes as well. That you may want to pick up with us afterwards. So, just by way of introduction, this is the introduction obviously from Phil Davies as leader of the council, and in a nutshell, it's not just what we do, but how we do it that's going to be really important through this plan. I think it's also important to note that this is no longer to be seen as a council plan, it is a partner plan, it's the rural plan. So on the 15th of June there was a partnership summit, the 15th of July partnership summit, and there was a commitment from all the new partners that they wanted to embrace this as our plan, what we do with the rural island, and get ownership across the whole of the world. So the outcomes that are identified in this plan require partners to work very collaboratively to achieve these outcomes and work in a very different bringing all their money to the table to deliver these solutions. What's not identified in the plan is the budget that accompanies and underpins the plan. The budget really, if it's a partner's plan, is the whole of the amount of money in the rural economy that can be spent to achieve these outcomes. But what we do know is that there will be choices, there will be prioritisations, and there will be new solutions that we need to come up with, because all organisations are facing dwindling budgets, and the whole austerity approach will continue. So that's just what I wanted to say by way of introduction. So briefly then, we're going to three key areas. The first one is around people, the second one is around business, and the third one is environment. So in respect of people, it's a good place to start, as the families of our dear policy and performance committee. We've got the clear, bold headline that world's a place where the vulnerable are safe and protected, every child gets a good start in life, and older residents are respected and valued. There's a key requirement that we work across council and agency boundaries, and get a whole emphasis on this being everybody's responsibility to deliver these outcomes. So, I think only part of this has worked. So it's a good test for all about how this PowerPoint works, because I think in the... Oh, you can see them on there. I can't remember, sorry. So the key areas, you'll see a difference in how these outcomes are represented from perhaps from previous plans, because there's been a lot of work with officers, with members, to think through how that we really come up with some very bold outcomes that aren't specifically restricted to individual organisations or disciplines. So if you just take one, I'm particularly familiar with children ready for school. The way we've been talking about this particular outcome is there are lots of organisations working with 0 to 5 year olds or children, even parents pre-births, children pre-births. So the local authority now puts £3.1 million into its early years and children's centres once we've made the reductions. But we know that there is, it's like bags of money to put on the table, the £16 million that the government gives, DfE gives, for the 2, 3 and 4 year old nursery offer. We know that there's £5 million in the 0 to 5 health visiting, family nurse partnership offer. We know there's money, Rural Hospital Trust spent on antenatal care, midwifery services. We know there's money in the private sector, we know there's money brought in through the voluntary community faith sector. If you put all that money on the table and think boldly, bravely, without walls almost, and think, what do we do across the whole of Wirral in a really ambitious way to make sure every single child in Wirral starts school bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, ready to learn? You've got 23, 25 million in order to do that. Now, I know some of the money's got specific requirements attached to it, about nursery places and how you deliver health visiting. But there must be a way of lifting ourselves right up and thinking, are there creative different ways that strip out some of the duplication and gaps that we probably currently have? And how do we put the most vulnerable children at the heart of that, even though it's a universal offer? So that's just a little example, but I think you can apply that methodology to all of those outcomes. And we've done quite a lot of work in thinking, you know, for example, we've got older people who live well, and this is in the context of the numbers of older people increasing quite significantly. The majority of older people are well and fit and able. There are more vulnerable older people within that cohort. But if how do you enable across the whole economy and everyone involved, not least the older people themselves, how do we shape the future to, you know, by 2020 and beyond, that more older people will work? We're trying to put some measures beneath that to evidence that we're making steps towards achieving those outcomes. So, there are the key outcomes there. The next area is in respect of our business environment. So, Wirral's a place where employers want to invest and businesses thrive. With a focus on real priority growth areas to promote and grow jobs in the visitor economy, advanced manufacturing, maritime, renewable energy sectors. And a real emphasis again on working with partners to make sure that these ambitions are delivered and that the plans are both economically and environmentally sustainable. So a key strand that whatever you do is environmentally sensitive and works. So again, we have to come back with a little bit of fame, so that comes through if you watch it long enough, yes. So again, we have a set of outcomes. And you see how they're expressed again, so in terms of thriving small businesses, greater job opportunities in rural, a real focus on assets and buildings are fit for purpose. If you think about assets for a minute, and if you take an aerial map of rural, there'll be health assets, there'll be schools, not very school that's coming to cabinet tomorrow, but there's schools that are no longer used. Have we got our assets in the right locations? Could we combine the use of assets and think across the whole of the partnership? Next area is environment. So again, here with a real focus on outcomes, that rural has an attractive and sustainable environment where good health and excellent quality of life is enjoyed by everyone who lives here. And a particular emphasis here on narrowing the gap and reducing levels of inequality, particularly in respect of health. And so a real focus on residents having a good quality of life, healthy lifestyles in a clean and safe environment. So here you'll see an area that Julie and Fiona and colleagues are particularly focusing on, but it's much broader than just, for example, public health, as we're saying with all of these areas. So rural residents live healthier lives, rural neighbourhoods are safe, we've got good quality housing. And under each of these areas you will see there are discrete targets, so there are more details being worked up about the outcome indicators with each of these. So if we move on then to delivering the plan, again an emphasis in trying to strive to keep momentum, that if we deliver the plan effectively, residents will see better job opportunities, quality local environment and better health. Older people live longer, children have a better start in life. Throughout all the people agenda is making sure that people feel safe and are safe as well. That looks like a golden thread through the outcomes. So, three key aspects underpinning kind of cross-cutting areas in terms of delivering the plan. We need to make sure that all the work in moving forward in delivering these outcomes is based on good intelligence and insight. And what communities and local people are telling us to report to them. Just to give you an example, Julie and I sit on a panel usually most years with the Youth Parliament, and we meet with youngsters who have spent, it's not the actual parliament in the committee room, they have a youth voice conference, that's what it's called. And when we are about to go on this panel, multidisciplinary panel with the senior person from the police and a senior person from fire and rescue and public health and children's services, we try and guess what kind of questions the young people are going to ask. And we've got wise there, but the first year we were thinking they were going to ask questions about youth clubs, they're going to ask questions about doing exams, all these things we thought they might ask. None of them asked any of those questions. They were asking questions about homophobic bullying, they were asking questions about pressure at school, they were asking questions about when the council talks about young people and publicises things, how we use real images of youngsters and not clip art. All these kind of things that mattered to them, issues to do with social media, and we actually have that really detailed level of what young people or adults tell us is important to us, that will help shape and inform how we deliver these outcomes. And it might result in us having a very different set of services than we currently have. Given some of the earlier comments about reducing resources as well. But if you properly engage with people, so this is about having a different kind of consultation and gaining intelligence and insight. Everything we do will be in collaboration with others, so I can stress that as a thread running through this, and a focus on being a modern public service, so using efficient and fit for the digital world and making sure that we have the right attitudes and skills and abilities to deliver the outcomes that we're identifying. So, final bit, in terms of the delivery plan timetable, the delivery plan is currently in development. We'll have a first draft published in October, and between October and December will be the phase one, first scrutiny of priorities and deliverables, and we'll be engaged in discussions with partners. Moving on to draft two being published in February. the initial scrutiny phase, it will be a review of the delivery plan content, identifying the key priorities. There will be workshops, is my understanding, of this committee and other committees during October and November to examine the proposals and the draft plan in more detail. Report back to December committees to inform the delivery of the set or the development of the second draft of the delivery plan. And we'll then review the second delivery plan, prioritise the delivery plan activities, and will be a schedule for areas of greater scrutiny in the new plan that will then be published. So finally, just coming right back to where we are now. The next steps are we'll invite comments on the plan and seek feedback to be brought to the coordinating committee on the 30th of September. The committee will then agree, that coordinating committee, which Councillor McLaughlin chairs,
she does,
will agree a consistent process across all the committees for phase one of scrutiny. That was between October and December. And the committee will consider prioritisation in areas of potential overlap between the committees. Because you see, there's lots of areas that cut across different individual committees. So Graham and I will have a view about housing strategies, colleagues will have a view about where we build new schools potentially, if that needs to be linked to new business coming into the authority. So they're all interlinked and determinedly not in silos of individual departments and services. Thank you.
Thank you, dear. Any questions? Treena?
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure that us councillors will be involved in these set processes by ways of being on task and finish groups or healthcare performance panel meetings and things like that. Is that right to be saying that? Or we will be having a say in this, yeah?
There will be a specific, at least one, I think it will be one workshop for the members of this committee to delve deeper into the people priorities. And then that will be arranged in during, I think, late October and November time.
Thank you.